The views expressed in this program are for informational purposes only and do not constitute investment advice. Investing in ETFs involves risk, including the potential loss of principal. Any past performance figures discussed are not necessarily indicative of future results. Visit ETFstore.com for more information. Now it's time for the ETF Store Show. The investment pros at the ETF Store discuss everything you need to know about exchange-traded funds and the world of investing. Whether you're an investing expert or just starting out, Nate and Connor will help you get up to date on what's happening on Wall Street and show you how exchange-traded funds can help lower your investment costs, reduce your tax bill, and allow you to take advantage of investment opportunities around the world. And now, the host of the ETF Store Show, Nate Geraci.
Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the ETF Store Show. Nate Geraci and Connor Kelly in studio this morning. Thanks for tuning in. And as always, if you have questions on anything that we discuss on today's show, or if you would like more information about investing in ETFs, you can call an ETF Store investment advisor today at 816-363-ETFs. That's 816-363-3837. Or you can visit us online at ETFstore.com. So today we're going to talk to one of the largest ETF providers in the world. And actually, if you look at where investors placed their money in 2013, this ETF provider was right there at the top, and that's Vanguard. And some of you may know that Vanguard was founded by Jack Bogle, who many consider to be the father of index investing. And Vanguard has really hung their hat on index investing and lowering investment costs. So this morning, we'll talk with Chris Phillips, senior investment analyst at Vanguard, to get his thoughts on indexing versus active management. We'll talk about the importance of investment costs, and then we'll also take a look at a few of the Vanguard ETFs. Now, later on in the show, Connor and I will have a quick market update for you, and we'll also spotlight a Vanguard ETF holding over 5,000 stocks around the world. Good show today, and if you have questions or comments, you can find us on Twitter, or you can send them to us by going to ETFstore.com. So Chris Phillips with Vanguard will join us in just a bit, but before he does so, I want to sort of set the stage for our conversation with Chris by spending a few minutes talking about the performance of index-based funds versus actively managed funds. And as I mentioned, Vanguard has really built their very successful business on index investing. They now manage over $2 trillion, and the bulk of that is in index funds with about $350 billion in ETFs. Now, as we've talked about on past shows, the vast majority of all ETFs are index-based. That's one of the main reasons we like to use them here at the ETF Store. And when we say index-based, that simply means the fund is attempting to track a particular group of stocks or bonds or other securities, the S&P 500 index, for example. Now, that's different than with actively managed funds, where you're paying a manager to select the stocks or bonds or other securities that they think will outperform these same indexes. And regular listeners of the show know that this is a subject we cover fairly often, but new data continues to come out. And Connor, look, people are still putting a lot of money into actively managed funds.
Nate, they are. And it comes down to the allure of getting outperformance and thinking that, you know, finding a smart money manager is you know, automatically going to result in better performance than an index fund. I mean, people are competitive, and who doesn't want to win? Who doesn't think that they are the person that can find that money manager that can outperform whatever benchmark? But I think the problem is most people fall into the trap that if they think they just find the right person or the right mutual fund, that they're going to have outstanding performance, but the data obviously doesn't support that.
Well, and I think index funds almost come across as boring to some investors. And I think when you look at actively managed funds, that potential you're mentioning, Connor, for outsized returns and the feeling like maybe you're getting a leg up on the market seems a whole lot more exciting. And I think that comes through even in the way mutual fund companies market to investors. If you watch some of these mutual fund commercials, they almost give you the sense that they have some secret inside information that's going to help you get better returns. Listen to a couple of commercials I pulled. This first one is from T. Rowe Price.
How could a luminous protein in jellyfish impact life expectancy in the U.S., real estate in Hong Kong, and the optics industry in Germany? At T. Rowe Price, we understand the connections of a complex global economy. It's just one reason to consider our disciplined investment approach. T. Rowe Price. Invest with confidence. Request a prospectus or summary prospectus with investment information, risks, fees, and expenses to read and consider carefully before investing.
And look, you know, that sounds exciting. You have the very smart people at T. Rowe Price connecting all the dots for you, you know, from jellyfish to the optics industry in Germany. And I think the inference here is that you're going to get some specialized market knowledge that will help deliver better returns. Here's another one from Franklin Templeton.
In my country, the investment landscape changes continually. At Franklin Templeton, we've been here for decades to see it firsthand.
Our investment insights start on the ground, with local analysts spotting opportunities and risks as they emerge.
When opportunity grows in your backyard, you can see first what others see eventually.
Invest through the eyes of hundreds of local experts worldwide. Franklin Templeton Investments. Gain from our perspective.
So here they're touting local analysts that they have on the ground all around the world who can find the best investment opportunities for you. And that obviously sounds like a pretty good deal. You know, surely they'll be able to deliver better returns since they have this this great team of analysts. But you might be surprised to learn how mutual funds like these have actually performed. And I want to quickly walk through some numbers that I have for you this morning.
Nate, real quick, let me jump in. I want to make it clear to our listeners that we're not picking on T. Rowe Price or Franklin Templeton. The point is, what we're trying to do is make a point of, these are very well done commercials. And I think a lot of our listeners have seen them because they're on TV quite often. But look, at the end of the day, they're advertisements, and effective advertisements convince you, you know, that you need to buy whatever product that they're talking about. And that, and we need to just, you know, make it a distinction between reality and what the, you know, very impressive stories that they are selling on their commercials, because there's a broad gap there in between the reality of their performance and what they're trying to sell on their ads.
Well, right. These commercials are really selling the allure of the potential for these outsized returns. And the good news is that we have the data, or the report card, so to speak, showing how well these actively managed mutual funds have done. And again, I think this data might come as a surprise to some people. And the data I'm referring to comes from something called the SPIVA scorecard. This is published by a company called S&P Dow Jones Indices. And we'll post this at our website at etfstore.com. But simply put, it compares how well these actively managed mutual funds have performed versus their benchmark indexes. And the results, I think, are just mind-boggling. So, for example, over the 5 years ending June 30th, 2013, 72% of all domestic stock mutual funds underperformed their benchmark. 66% of all international stock funds underperformed, and 90% of investment-grade long bond funds underperformed. And there was another great study recently done by Vanguard, and they looked at all actively managed U.S. equity funds that existed in 1998 and through the end of 2012. And they found that out of 1,540 funds, listen to this, 698 of the funds closed. And I would add that that was likely because of underperformance. 567 funds survived but underperformed their benchmarks, and 275 funds survived and outperformed their benchmarks. In other words, if you crunch those numbers, more than 80% of the funds either closed or underperformed or both. And Connor, we're going to talk to Chris Phillips from Vanguard about this, but this data is pretty darn compelling.
It is, Nate. And look, we're only talking about two resources on the subject, the SPIVA report card and Vanguard's own reports, but we happen to think they're two fantastic resources. But we always encourage our listeners, you know, who aren't convinced of the benefits of ETFs and index investing, to do the research yourselves. Spend a little time on Google, and you're going to find a plethora of information, pro-mutual fund, pro-ETF, and make your own decision. But at the end of the day, these stats reinforce why we use ETFs to manage our client assets at the ETF store. We would much rather capture market returns than have an 80% chance of underperforming our benchmark. Well, we would take those odds every single day.
Well, Connor, that actually brings up something else that I want to hit on, and we have to head to break here in just a moment, but I know some investors will say, Well, who cares if 80% of mutual funds underperform? I'll just pick the ones that outperform. Well, the problem with this approach is there's no persistency to mutual fund performance. And here's what I mean by that. According to S&P Dow Jones Indices, as of September 30th, 2013, out of all U.S. mutual funds, only slightly more than 2%, that's 2%, were able to stay in the top 25% of mutual fund rankings for five consecutive years. So what this is telling you is that mutual fund managers can't consistently sustain any outperformance they may have in a given year or years. That makes it very challenging if you're trying to pick from the small percentage of mutual fund managers who may outperform. And one other quick note on this, there was a fantastic study recently done by Russell Investments, which tracked how well Morningstar-rated mutual funds had performed. Many of you may be familiar with the Morningstar ranking system, where they rate funds from 1 to 5 stars. Well, Russell looked at all of the funds rated by Morningstar in 2002, and then they tracked the performance of these funds through 2013. And guess what? The 1-star funds actually outperformed the 5-star rated funds. Now, look, you can interpret that as maybe an indictment of Morningstar's rating system, but I view this more as showing just how difficult it is for active managers to sustain any sort of outperformance. You know, Morningstar has all the resources in the world to evaluate mutual funds, and I think a study like this shows just how difficult it is to identify managers who one, will outperform, and then two, who can sustain that outperformance.
Well, Nate, I think to summarize, because we're throwing a lot of numbers, I mean, you know, if you feel like 20% of mutual funds can outperform in a given year, those aren't terrible odds. You know, 1 out of 5, some people might say, okay, with a little extra research, some digging, you know, I can find that 1 out of 5. But the problem is the persistency year to year, the outperformance is truly random. So to the point you made that only 2% of funds actually retain, you know, basically top 25% performance for a 5-year stretch, I mean, then you're talking about some, you know, very unlikely odds of you being able to find that fund that can outperform more than just any given year.
Well, and 1 out of 5 odds still certainly aren't something that's working in your favor. Well, let's take a break. And when we come back, Chris Phillips, senior investment analyst at Vanguard, will join us on the show. We'll ask him why active managers have such a difficult time outperforming the markets. And we'll also talk some Vanguard ETFs. This is the ETF Store Show on ESPN 1510.
Want a more beautiful, livable home? Talk to Schlegel Design Remodel. No one offers more ways to add value to your home while saving you money.
I'm Jake Schlegel. We have services for every need, like our popular one-week bath and express custom kitchen remodels, completed in a lot less time for a lot less money. We also offer professional handyman services for chores around your home.
Whatever your needs, call Schlegel Design Remodel, 816-361-9669, or go to remodelagain.com today.
Hi, this is David Van Oy of the Van Oy Group at Reese & Nichols Realtors. Thanks for listening to my friends at the ETF Store. When making decisions about buying or selling a home, you need first someone who is knowledgeable and someone you can trust. With 9 years of experience and over $40 million in residential sales, I would love an opportunity to apply for that job. If you would like more information on a specific home or a property evaluation in Missouri, call 536-SOLD. In Kansas, call 259-HOME. Or go to our website, thevanoygroup.com.
Is your investment portfolio on track to meet your retirement goals? Unfortunately, most people can't answer that question. In fact, many people haven't done any retirement planning at all. Hi, I'm Nate Geraci with the ETF Store, an investment advisor located right here in Kansas City. Let us help you build a retirement plan and work to achieve your financial goals. Call us today at 816-363-3837 or visit us online at etfstore.com. And don't forget to tune in to the ETF Store Show every Tuesday at 9 a.m. on ESPN 1510.
When refinancing a mortgage, all of the numbers can become confusing. With First Mortgage Solutions, you only need to remember 2, 500, and 0. $500 is the amount our average customer saves every month after refinancing. And 0 is the number of loans we've ever done that have ended up in default. At First Mortgage Solutions, business is based on dollars and cents. Saving you dollars with loans that make sense. For more information, call 816-778-7000 or apply online at firstmortgagekc.com. NMLS number 244476.
Tired of running around town trying to find the best products for your business? Regal Distributing can help. With over 9,000 stock products in categories like food service packaging, professional facilities, office supplies, and sustainable janitorial solutions, you'll be sure to find what you need at Regal. Visit us on the web at GetRegal.com or call locally at 913-894-8787. And don't forget to check out Regal's state-of-the-art showroom and training center located off 435 and K-10 Highway. Go with the local partner you can trust. Go with Regal, distributing service and solutions since 1955.
There's never a bad time to see your dentist. So if you haven't been for a while or if one of your teeth is actually starting to hurt, it's always easier to fix it before it gets worse. We aren't anti-dentites like the Seinfeld episode, so give Dr. Kevin or Matt Cummings a call at 816-246-1003 or check us out on our website, www.cummingsdentistry.com. Remember, floss the ones you want to keep and mention this ad and get a 10% discount on your first visit.
Welcome back to the ETF Store Show on ESPN 1510. Nate Geraci along with Connor Kelly in studio this morning. So today we've been talking about index-based passive investing versus actively managed investments. And I would say there's no other fund company more tied to index-based investing than Vanguard. Founder Jack Bogle launched the first index fund back in 1976. And the company has become one of the world's largest fund companies with over $2 trillion in assets. About $350 billion of that is in index-based ETFs. I'm now pleased to have joining us via phone from Valley Forge, Pennsylvania, just outside of Philadelphia, Chris Phillips, Senior Investment Analyst with Vanguard. Chris, glad to have you with us this morning.
Well, thanks so much for having us on.
Well, Chris, we spent the first part of the show today providing some data on how active fund managers have fared versus their benchmark indexes. And in April of last year, you actually co-authored a white paper on this exact subject titled The Case for Index Fund Investing. And the main conclusion of that paper was that low-cost index funds display a greater probability of outperforming higher-cost actively managed funds. And we've covered the data today. So I think what everyone wants to know is, why is this the case? Why are these seemingly smart, talented fund managers more likely to underperform?
Yeah, it's one of the most common questions we get on this particular topic. And I think the easiest way I can think about answering that is if you take a big step back and think about who makes up the investment markets, globally speaking, there's probably a million plus CFA charter holders. There's probably another million plus CFP designation holders. There's very sophisticated investors that have PhDs, MBAs, you name it, all the credentials in the world, very, very smart individuals. With a ton of technology and information at their hands. And that technology, that information, the intellect is just increasing rapidly over time. And so when you think about the investing world, all these individuals are playing against each other. And whether it's a hedge fund, whether it's a Vanguard, whether it's a Fidelity, whether it's a bank in Switzerland or Japan, all these investment players make up the marketplace.
Well, so go ahead, Chris.
For stocks and bonds globally, and they're all playing against each other.
Well, so obviously these smart, talented managers, they're beating each other up. Where do fees come into play here in terms of performance? When you look at the performance of actively managed funds versus index funds?
Yeah, the fees are one of the biggest drivers of why passive does so well. So if you think in terms of one manager trying to pick a bunch of stocks that they think will outperform, someone has to sell them those stocks. One might be right, the other might be wrong. At the end of the day, the index fund investor is going to say, thank you very much for setting the price of those stocks. I'm going to take that price and invest accordingly. And the cost to do that is very, very small. It could be 2 basis points, 10 basis points, but compare that to active managers that might be charging 90, 150 basis points. That's a tremendous hurdle year over year for an active manager to overcome just to break even with a passively managed product.
All right. In the paper you wrote, you show we're over a 10-year time period ending in December 2012. 83% of large cap value equity funds either underperformed or closed altogether. And this fits in with the data we were discussing earlier in the show. I'm curious, with this kind of data readily available to investors and with how lopsided it is, why do you think actively managed mutual funds still have so much money invested in them?
I think the easiest thing I can say is hope springs eternal. I think there's a combination of investors and advisors and really the community at large just hopes that they can find a better way or some secret sauce, and that allure of actually having some outperformance is a huge draw for both investors and money managers. I mean, we have to be real that there's a lot of money chasing these types of strategies, and there's a lot of individuals out there in Wall Street or in hedge funds or in active shops that get paid a lot of money to try and do this on a daily basis. So I think you compound that with a general perception that it really can't be that simple, right? I mean, and I think that combination of those two mentalities, there has to be a better way, really drive people to want to have the chance for outperformance, even if the odds are stacked against them.
Well, one of the things I found very interesting from your white paper was that investors who are building portfolios using actively managed mutual funds had a higher level of volatility. Why is this?
Well, in order to differentiate yourself from the benchmark to try and get some outperformance, you really have to take bets. And the active management world tends to take those bets in areas of the marketplace where they think they can add the most value. But I think what we need to understand is that anytime you differentiate yourself from a market index or a benchmark portfolio, by definition, you're increasing the risk levels of that portfolio in some way. Now, it might not be just volatility, there might be liquidity, some other types of more hidden risks, but anytime you differ from the benchmark portfolio, you have to be riskier. So that's a mathematical certainty, and it actually shows up in the data that these managers are basically trying to outperform by adding risk into the portfolio, but it just hasn't worked out that way. They've added more risk, but underperformed.
All right, we've mentioned the importance of investment cost in this, and if we look at some of the largest Vanguard ETFs, we'll find expense ratios of 0.1% or even less, which is significantly less expensive than actively managed funds. So two questions here. One, how is Vanguard able to offer such low-cost ETFs? And then two, I think some investors equate lower investment costs to lower quality investments. And where do you think that comes from?
Yeah, I think that I'm going to answer your second question first. I think that comes from the rest of our experience as human beings. So if you think in terms of buying a new car, right, if you pay a little bit more, odds are you probably get a little bit better product, whether it's a TV, washing machine, whatever it might be. And so the consumer mentality that we have as human beings tends to lend itself to the same level of perception within investing. The challenge is it doesn't work that way. And I think I heard the tail end of your previous segment talking about the Morningstar ratings. And again, if you think in terms of like a consumer report, higher rated products tend to be better products. And that might not work out the same way in investing. And so whether it's academic research or research at Vanguard or other industry providers, one of the most consistent ways that people have found to predict relative performance has been the expense ratio or the all-in cost of a particular fund. So that gets to how Vanguard can offer such low expense ratios. The key here is that Vanguard is structured as an at-cost provider. So all of our funds operate at cost. Any excess revenues that might be due from, say, a trading or hypothetically if there was a fee on a transaction, all that gets put back into the portfolio. So Vanguard's never taking any excess revenues or profits from these portfolios. They all have to stand on their own. So the cost to run a fund is exactly what you see it as is, which is a huge differentiator for Vanguard in the industry.
All right, Chris, let's talk some specific Vanguard ETFs now. And two of your three largest ETFs are the Vanguard FTSE Emerging Markets ETF, ticker VWO, and the Vanguard FTSE Developed Markets ETF, ticker VEA, both covering international stocks. Let's take VEA first. Talk a little bit about what this ETF does.
So this ETF, VEA, is designed to track The countries outside of the U.S. that would be considered developed markets. So that would be your European countries such as Germany or the U.K. Canada's in there, Japan, Australia in there. So your big developed markets as defined by the benchmark providers. So its objective is to give you broad coverage of all the securities that fall into that marketplace.
Okay, and then the other ETF I mentioned was ticker VWO, which covers emerging markets. And, you know, that's certainly been a tough place for investors to be over the last couple of years. Tell us a little bit about VWO, and then I'd love to get your take on emerging markets right now.
Sure. So VWO, as you mentioned, does track the emerging markets universe. So emerging markets, by definition, are those countries or regions of the world that might have some hurdle yet to overcome before they are classified as developed. So it could be economic, it could be in terms of market structure, it could be in terms of the legal standing, how free a particular country is, whether investors have significant protections in that country. So there's a number of hurdles. So if you think in terms of, say, a Russia or a China or a Chile or some of these countries that might have still a lot of development in some areas of either economy, governments, or markets left to do, that would really constitute that emerging market. So, yes, last year was a little bit of a challenge. It was actually the first year, probably in the last 10 to 12 years, where emerging markets has significantly underperformed developed markets or the U.S. And so it was, I think, a big wake-up call for a lot of investors that, oh, wait a second, there is risk here. It was kind of this one-way street for many years where you put money in emerging markets, you're almost guaranteed to outperform. And a lot of that snapped back to reality last year.
Well, Chris, that brings up a good point. How should investors view emerging markets in their portfolio? What do you see as the role of emerging market stocks?
So we do view emerging markets as having a permanent place in investors' portfolios, whether they are accumulators or spenders. And the reason being is that they are part of the investable marketplace. And so excluding them is necessarily placing a bet against them. Does it mean that for a retiree, for example, you should have 50% in emerging markets? No. I think we all need to have a reasonable discussion around what an appropriate allocation would be. But Vanguard, when we think in terms of what we would advise clients, we start with market proportional. And what that means is that if you just think in terms of outside of the U.S., emerging markets make up around 25% of non-U.S. stocks in the marketplace. And so that's where we would start. We would say if you combine VEA and VWO, VEA might make up 75% of that allocation and VWO might make up 25%. Then you add that into whatever you have in the U.S. That would be a fairly baseline, reasonable allocation to start with.
All right. Well, we're on the subject of international investing. Vanguard launched the Total International Bond ETF last year, ticker BNDX. And we talked about this on the show with your colleague Jim Rowley back at that time. I'm curious, how is this ETF done? And what role can international bonds play in an investor's portfolio?
Sure. Actually, this has been one of Vanguard's most successful product launches in a number of years. We launched in June of last year, and as of last count, we are at around $22 billion in the fund and ETF collectively. Now, to be sure, a big chunk of that was because we did incorporate it into our advice methodology and added it to our target date fund series. So there is some fund-to-funds money that's allocated there. But as a standalone product, the ETF itself has already crossed the billion-dollar threshold, which tends to be that benchmark for a successful portfolio. Our views around emerging market bonds is actually somewhat interesting. And a lot of investors out there, most that I talk to actually, don't realize that international bonds are the single largest asset class in the investing world. And yet most of us don't have any or very little exposure to international bonds. So this was our way of getting a product out there that we felt that we could offer in the traditional Vanguard way, i.e. indexed at very low cost in a format that would benefit the end user to enable investors to have or increase their exposure to emerging market bonds.
All right, Chris, we have just a couple of minutes left here, and I thought we'd close today. I'd love to get your take just on fixed income in general. And I think for a lot of investors, what happened last year with a spike in interest rates over the summer really caught some investors off guard. They hadn't seen bonds really go down in their portfolios. I'm curious, moving forward, how you think long-term investors should approach fixed income in their portfolio.
Yeah, and this is actually a question that has been the hot topic for us for probably the last year and a half now. I think last year, there's two things that I would like to cover. One is that I don't want to ever get away from the role that bonds play in a portfolio. And we do believe very, very strongly that bonds play the role of ballast in the portfolio. They are that risk diversifier in the portfolio. The minute we start hearing clients or someone else talk about moving from fixed income into, say, dividend-paying stocks, or maybe even something as exotic as an alternative asset class, we get very, very queasy because at the end of the day, stocks are stocks and bonds are bonds. And if you think in terms of what bonds experienced last year, the Barclays Ag lost around 2% in a period of rising rates. 2% is a bad day in the stock market. And that was a full year return for the bond market. So, yes, stocks did very, very well last year. Bonds lost money for the first time in many, many years, and probably for the first time that a lot of investors can remember. And I think that was the biggest reason for the concerns and the questions that were raised. But we never want to lose sight of the role that bonds play in the portfolio. The second point I'd like to make is, since we are talking active-passive, is that if you think back to the last couple of years, every active manager out there had been positioning their portfolio to take advantage of a rising rate environment. And they were anticipating it, and last year it happened. Well, what happened in the marketplace? 75% of active managers failed to outperform their benchmark last year, despite the fact that rates rose and they've been prepping for it and preparing and planning for it. So, again, I think that we need to always remember what bonds do. They provide that diversification. And that it's not as simple as saying, I know that rates will rise, therefore I can do X, Y, or Z in the portfolio.
Well, Chris, we'll have to leave it there, but we certainly appreciate your time this morning. Thank you.
Thank you so much for having me.
That was Chris Phillips, Senior Investment Analyst at Vanguard. Let's take a break, and when we come back, we'll have a quick market update and then spotlight a Vanguard ETF. This is the ETF Store Show on ESPN 1510.
While it's not often talked about, the fact is that many Americans struggle to manage their finances. It's no wonder, since most people are never taught the basic personal finance skills they need to be successful. We can do better. Imagine an entire generation that makes sound financial decisions. The Missouri Council on Economic Education is a nonprofit organization in our community that believes this is possible. They are already working with local schools to teach economics and personal finance, but they need your help. To learn more or to get involved, visit moeconomics.org. That's moeconomics.org.
Is your investment portfolio on track to meet your retirement goals? Unfortunately, most people can't answer that question. In fact, many people haven't done any retirement planning at all. Hi, I'm Nate Geraci with the ETF Store, an investment advisor located right here in Kansas City. Let us help you build a retirement plan and work to achieve your financial goals. Call us today at 816-363-3837 or visit us online at etfstore.com. And don't forget to tune in to the ETF Store Show every Tuesday at 9 a.m. on ESPN 1510.
Will you profit from rising food prices?
Bulk Food International.
Do you want a tangible asset besides gold or silver?
Bulk Food International.
Would you like to own an investment that will be valuable 10, 20, 30 years from now?
Bulk Food International.
With Bulk Food International, you can own a variety of food products that will be viable and valuable for years to come. Bulk Food International will store your products for you or deliver to your location. Best of all, you can use your IRA or 401k funds to make your purchase. Bulk Food International, 816-888-8290. Investing in your future.
Typical estate planning is transactional, focused solely on money, offering cookie-cutter documents, resulting in plans that do not address what is truly important to you and your loved ones. Bridge Builder's unique planning process focuses on the three dimensions of family wealth: financial, what you own, human, who you are, and intellectual, what you know. Bridge Builder, Plans for Life, Architects at Protecting and Perpetuating Family Wealth for Generations. Please contact Bridge Builder for a free consultation at 913-956-3984.
For those of you who haven't heard, the oldest building in Kansas City has the newest rooftop deck. Kelly's Westport Inn's rooftop deck has a full-service bar, TVs, bathrooms, lots of fans, and an awesome view of Westport. Kelly's has a weekday happy hour Monday through Friday from 3 to 7. They also have live music every Friday and Saturday night. Come enjoy tunes from bands like Lost Wax, Flanagan's Right Hook, and Michael Beer's Band. Every city has a place where the elite gather for witty conversation over trendy cocktails. In Kansas City, that place is definitely not Kelly's. For more information, go to kellyswestportinn.com.
There's never a bad time to see your dentist. So if you haven't been for a while or if one of your teeth is actually starting to hurt, it's always easier to fix it before it gets worse. We aren't anti-dentites like the Seinfeld episode, so give Dr. Kevin or Matt Cummings a call at 816-246-1003 or check us out on our website, www.cummingsdentistry.com. Remember, floss the ones you want to keep and mention this ad and get a 10% discount on your first visit.
Welcome back to the ETF Store Show on ESPN 1510. Now it's time for our weekly market update.
And now it's time for this week's market update. Tune in every week as the ETF Store brings you the information you need to know on the financial markets.
It was a pretty nice week for stocks last week. The Spider S&P 500 ETF up over a full percent. The Vanguard Developed Markets ETF was up close to a third of a percent. And the Schwab Emerging Markets Equity ETF was up just over 0.75% for the week. Taking a look at bonds, interest rates were up last week, so bonds were down. The iShares 7- to 10-year Treasury Bond ETF was down over 1%. And then finally, looking at some alternative investments, the iShares Gold Trust was up over 1%. And the Rogers International Commodity ETN was up approaching 1.5% for the week. So I do want to hit on just a couple of items from last week. It was fairly quiet in terms of economic data, but the Fed did release their beige book report on Wednesday. And probably the most noteworthy item in this report was some commentary on slower economic growth due to the unusually severe winter weather we've seen in many parts of the country. And it was interesting. I saw where someone had tallied how many times the word weather or snow or ice was used in the report, and that came to 145 times. So the weather was clearly something that the Fed saw as meaningful in terms of economic impact. But outside of that, the report maintained a fairly optimistic tone, and there was no indication the Fed was going to alter their tapering plan. The February jobs report also came out last week. That was on Friday. It was pretty strong. 175,000 new jobs were added, and the size of the labor force increased, so that was certainly a positive. But outside of that, you know, there really wasn't much else of note. This crisis in Ukraine continues to sort of lurk in the backdrop, but nothing really new here. So, Connor, I guess the beat goes on. The market had a pretty good week last week.
Yeah, the market had a nice week, Nate, but, you know, the start of the year, economically speaking, the weather has certainly added some noise to the data. But what's clear with the recovery in the stock market since the end of January, that both investors in the market and the Fed have essentially given a hall pass to the U.S. economy for the start of the year, certainly the first 2 months, if not the first quarter, where we're just all, I guess, to the point where we're riding off a brutally cold, snowy winter for most of the country as an excuse for getting out of the gate a little bit slow. Now, looking forward, you know, we're not going to have bad weather as an excuse when we start looking at, you know, March and in the second quarter of GDP and all these other, you know, jobs reports and other economic figures we look at. So we're going to be very interested to see that the economy does get back on track, because again, the Fed and the general investing public and the market have obviously all taken the weather as a valid excuse as to why we've had kind of a slow start out of the gate to start the year.
Well, and this gets back into what we've talked about, shoot, over the last 6 to 9 months, where if you look at last year's stock market returns, I think many investors believe that was fueled by this continued printing of money by the Federal Reserve. And as we moved into 2014, the question is, is the economy going to take the baton, so to speak, from the Fed?
Mm-hmm.
And if you look at how stocks performed in January and then what we saw in February, stocks were down pretty sharply in January, then up in February. You can see the market sort of in this tug of war, really grappling with whether or not the economy is in fact really improving. Now, we know the economy has continued to get marginally better, sort of this slow incremental growth, but it hasn't been lighting the world on fire. And so to your point, Connor, the weather really distorted some of the economic data coming out, and it gave investors more of a muddled or muddy picture about what was going on. So now as we head into the spring here, I do think investors are going to continue to be really poring over all of this economic data to see if we are getting that more significant uptake in economic growth.
Yeah, and we're going to need to see it, Nate. I mean, the numbers were not great in January and February with GDP and a lot of the other economic reports we look at. But again, they've kind of been written off, you know, that it's a bad winter. You know, that's just delaying everything, slowing everything down. But I'm sure we're still on track and growing. I mean, that is a general attitude that both the Fed and, the marketplace has taken. But we're not going to have that, hall pass, like I mentioned earlier, moving forward when we get into the nice weather this spring.
The other point I really want to drive home is that we spent a lot of time last year talking about how really diversification did not work in a portfolio. And what I mean by that, U.S. stocks by far in a way were the best performer last year. And a lot of the other assets that you may hold in a portfolio, emerging market stocks, like we talked about with Chris Phillips from Vanguard, you look at gold, commodities, some of the other asset classes, we know bonds didn't perform well. And so when you look at a diversified portfolio, it's kind of like you had U.S. stocks doing really well and not much from anything else. But as we turn the calendar into 2014, we've seen diversification really start to work a lot better. And so you look at something like gold, that's up 11%. You look at broad-based commodities up 5 or 6%.
Mm-hmm.
Even bonds had a great start in January. And so you've seen diversification sort of move back to the forefront. And I just think that's important because if you're a long-term investor and you're looking at what you want to own in a portfolio, having exposure to the wide variety of asset classes is going to serve you very well over the long run. And you're not going to be have the ups and downs that you may have if you're just loaded up on U.S. stocks.
Well, and I think diversification started working again once volatility re-entered the U.S. stock market like it did in January. Anything you owned last year that wasn't, U.S. stock, U.S. equity exposure, hurt performance compared to the, benchmarks that most people look at, which is the Dow or the S&P 500. I mean, anything that was not U.S. equities hurt last year compared to the broad U.S. market, but that has certainly not been the case this year as we've seen volatility enter the U.S. stock market again with, major indices being down 5%+ in January and then rallying all the way back just in a short February month.
But it will be interesting to continue to watch stocks. We've had just a tremendous run here since March of 2009, and I know all investors are watching to see what's going to happen here moving forward. Let's take a break, and when we come back, we'll do a quick ETF spotlight. This is the ETF Store Show on ESPN 1510.
Tired of running around town trying to find the best products for your business? Regal Distributing can help. With over 9,000 stock products in categories like food service packaging, professional facilities, office supplies, and sustainable janitorial solutions, you'll be sure to find what you need at Regal. Visit us on the web at getregal.com or call locally at 913-894-8787. And don't forget to check out Regal's state-of-the-art showroom and training center located off 435 and K-10 Highway. Go with the local partner you can trust. Go with Regal, distributing service and solutions since 1955.
Hi, this is David Van Oy of the Van Oy Group at Reese & Nichols Realtors. Thanks for listening to my friends at the ETF Store. When making decisions about buying or selling a home, you need first someone who is knowledgeable and someone you can trust. With 9 years of experience and over $40 million in residential sales, I would love an opportunity to apply for that job. If you would like more information on a specific home or a property evaluation in Missouri, call 536-SOLD. In Kansas, call 259-HOME. Or go to our website, thevanoygroup.com.
Is your investment portfolio on track to meet your retirement goals? Unfortunately, most people can't answer that question. In fact, many people haven't done any retirement planning at all.
Hi, I'm Nate Geraci with the ETF Store, an investment advisor located right here in Kansas City. Let us help you build a retirement plan and work to achieve your financial goals. Call us today at 816-363-3837 or visit us online at ETFstore.com. And don't forget to tune in to the ETF Store Show every Tuesday at 9 a.m. on ESPN 1510.
While it's not often talked about, the fact is that many Americans struggle to manage their finances. It's no wonder, since most people are never taught the basic personal finance skills they need to be successful. We can do better. Imagine an entire generation that makes sound financial decisions. The Missouri Council on Economic Education is a nonprofit organization in our community that believes this is possible. They are already working with local schools to teach economics and personal finance, but they need your help. To learn more or to get involved, visit moeconomics.org. That's moeconomics.org.
For those of you who haven't heard, the oldest building in Kansas City has the newest rooftop deck. Kelly's Westport Inn's rooftop deck has a full-service bar, TVs, bathrooms, lots of fans, and an awesome view of Westport. Kelly's has a weekday happy hour Monday through Friday from 3 to 7. They also have live music every Friday and Saturday night. Come enjoy tunes from bands like Lost Wax, Flanagan's Right Hook, and Michael Beer's Band. Every city has a place where the elite gather for witty conversation over trendy cocktails. In Kansas City, that place is definitely not Kelly's. For more information, go to kellyswestportinn.com.
Typical estate planning is transactional, focused solely on money, offering cookie-cutter documents, resulting in plans that do not address what is truly important to you and your loved ones. Bridge Builder's unique planning process focuses on the three dimensions of family wealth: financial, what you own; human, who you are; and intellectual, what you know. Bridge Builder, plans for life, architects at protecting and perpetuating family wealth for generations. Please contact Bridge Builder for a free consultation at 913-956-3984.
Has it been a while since you or your financial advisor reviewed the investments in your portfolio? With today's ever-changing global economy, it's become more critical than ever to make sure your portfolio is on track. Whether you're managing your own investments or using an advisor, it never hurts to get a second opinion. At the ETF Store, we provide free consultations on your portfolio. We'll highlight the strengths and weaknesses and tell you exactly what you're paying for your investments. This is absolutely free. There's no obligation. Just give us a call at 816-363-3837 or click on the free consultation button at ETFstore.com.
Welcome back to the ETF Store Show on ESPN 1510. Don't forget that every month on the show, we spotlight a listener question of the month. You can send us questions on anything investing or ETF related. Just go to ETFstore.com and click on the Ask the Host button, or you can send us your questions via Twitter. And if we select your question, we'll feature it on the show, and you'll receive a $50 gift card to Bella Napoli, the wonderful Italian restaurant down in Brookside. All right, let's get right to our weekly ETF Spotlight.
It's time for the ETF Spotlight, where each week the ETF Store highlights one exchange-traded fund. There are over 1,500 ETFs available to invest in. The ETF Store sorts through them so you don't have to.
Spotlighting this week is one that I think could make for an excellent core holding for investors wanting exposure to global stocks. It's the Vanguard Total World Stock ETF, ticker VT. And I've got to say, this may be one of my personal favorite ETFs that's out there. The single ETF covers approximately 98% of the world's total stock market capitalization. In other words, by investing in just this one ETF, you can have exposure to basically the fortunes of the vast majority of developed and emerging market stocks. As a matter of fact, this ETF currently holds nearly 5,400 individual stocks. Currently, this ETF has 53% exposure to North America, 24% to Europe, 14% to the Pacific, and about 9% to emerging markets. Now, here's the wonderful thing about this ETF. You would think that in order to get exposure to well over 5,000 stocks all around the world, you'd have to pay a pretty penny. Well, that's the big surprise here. In typical Vanguard fashion, you get this wonderful basket of stocks for, are you ready for this? 0.18%. In other words, it's nearly 8 times cheaper than the average actively managed mutual fund. Last year, VT returned 23%, and it's currently yielding a little over 2%. Connor, if you want broad-based global equity exposure, it's really hard not to like an ETF such as this.
Yeah, Nate, I mean, this is a simply wonderful ETF and really how, you know, just a perfect example of Vanguard and their belief in investing and what makes them a great firm. But I mean, let me repeat what you mentioned. I mean, this ETF covers essentially the entire stock market globally, 98% of it.
In one fund.
In one fund. I don't think there's a better building block ETF for investing broad asset allocation, especially you think if you're a new time investor and you just want to get started, you know, in a brokerage account and, you know, you're young and you're just getting into it. You know, this ETF plus paired with, you know, a global large bond ETF, you know, and essentially you've got broad asset exposure to almost the entire investment world in two ETFs. I mean, this is what has made Vanguard a simply dominant force and really the, as of a couple years ago, the largest mutual fund and ETF provider in the U.S. I mean, Vanguard has owned that title for several years, and ETFs like this is certainly a reason why.
Well, when I think of an ETF like this, where you are getting 5,400 stocks for 0.18%, it's hard not to compare it to actively managed mutual funds. And that's how we started off the program today, was by talking about the difference between an index-based ETF such as this and then actively managed mutual funds. And our point in that was walking through numbers on how these actively managed mutual funds had performed over time. And in the data, the way it plays out is that about 80% of actively managed mutual funds underperformed their benchmark index. Now, what we didn't talk a lot about with those mutual funds is that they typically cost about 1.4%. Okay, so as I mentioned, an ETF like this is 8 times cheaper. And so if you sit back and say, boy, if I want to have exposure to broad-based global equities, I can do it for 8 times less than the average actively managed mutual funds. I don't have that 80% chance that my active mutual fund is going to underperform. And the other thing that I'd want to add on there, we talked about the persistency. So even if you were able to find a fund 1 year that may outperform, the chances of you being able to do that year after year after year, they're just not in your favor. And so, Connor, I think you hit the nail on the head in terms of this might be a good ETF for. I think it could be a good ETF for any investor who wants to have it as a core holding. I think particularly for younger investors, mm-hmm. where they want to have exposure to the entire world stock market in one foul swoop, they can do that very easily through an ETF like this. Or I would also say, if you think about retirees, where maybe they have a fairly conservative portfolio, there's bonds in other types of fixed income in their portfolio, but they still want a little bit of upside in the equity markets. Well, they could get that through an ETF like VT.
Absolutely. And to put the cost in perspective, 0.81%, 18 basis points, what does that mean? For every $1,000 you invest in this ETF, it will cost you $1.80 per year. Think about that. That is how cheap this exposure is. And on the right online brokerage platform, you can find this ETF without a commission that trades for free on a lot of very popular online brokerages. So dirt cheap exposure as a building block core asset allocation piece.
And again, that ETF is the Vanguard Total World Stock ETF, ticker VT. Connor, we have just a few minutes left here on the show, and I did want to circle back around to some of the comments that Chris had made earlier. We had Chris Phillips from Vanguard on the program earlier in the show. In getting back into this active management conundrum, I thought he had a couple interesting points. One, he was talking just about how there are so many smart mutual fund managers out there, and that's part of the problem because they're all fighting with each other for the limited investment opportunities that exist. And he used the example, which I thought was a wonderful example, of going back to last year where basically everybody and their brother knew that interest rates were going to rise.
Correct.
And these active mutual fund bond managers, 75% of them, even though everybody knew that interest rates were going to rise, and they did, 75% of those mutual funds, those bond mutual funds, still underperformed. And
yeah.
I just thought that was alarming. And that really, to me, drove home the point of just how tough it is for these active mutual fund managers to generate outperformance.
Well, I thought the point that Chris made was perfect because it's a situation where you would expect some active management to show value. There's an expected occurrence that's going to happen down the road. Interest rates are going to rise. They have time to prepare their portfolios for that coming change. And then the change happened. They were right. The expectation of higher interest rates ended up working in their favor. So I thought the point that the fact that even along all of those things falling into place. 75% of bond fund managers still outperformed. Active bond managers still outperformed because their expenses are so high of a hurdle that they can't overcome them.
Yeah, and you know, one thing, I feel like we get pretty passionate on this program, Connor, talking about actively managed funds versus index funds. And I want to make the point, you know, if you're out there and you are invested in actively managed mutual funds, we don't bring the state up to come across as on a high horse and really beating you over the head on this data. We just want people to understand the data that is out there, and that if you're investing in actively managed mutual funds, unfortunately, the odds are not in your favor to find that outperformance in your portfolio. And we talked about how good of a job these mutual fund companies do in marketing. And they do make it sound exciting. And you look at index funds can come across as boring. But as we always say on the show, being boring when it comes to investing can actually be a very successful way to invest, especially over the long term. So, you know, I thought very interesting comments from Chris. And we will have to leave it there as we are out of time for today's show. I do want to thank Chris Phillips from Vanguard for joining us today. Again, I hope you enjoyed that conversation with Chris. And as always, don't forget that you can download full podcast of the ETF Store Show by going to ETFstore.com, or you can download the show for free directly from iTunes and now Stitcher Radio. Be sure to check us out on social media. We're on Twitter, Facebook, and LinkedIn. You can stay up to date on all the latest from both the ETF Store and the ETF Store Show. Thanks again for joining us this morning, and be sure to tune in next Tuesday at 9 a.m. as we continue discussing everything that you need to know about exchange-traded funds in the world of investing. Until then, have a great week, everyone.